In this next episode, I'm going to talk about analysis methods used in material extrusion. The last couple of episodes, we talked mostly about powder bed fusion and in particular polymer powder bed fusion. So I wanted to have a quick reminder what material extrusion is. If we look at the schematic, you're already familiar with it. You see that we have a build platform, we have our part that we're building on it, we need support structure, if you have overhangs, for example, and we have this extrusion head or print head that has at least one material, a thermoplastic material, fed into it and out of, in here, we conductively heat and melt the material, and then out of the nozzle, we extrude the material to build up the part. And if we have a second spool, that's typically the support material, it can be the same material and so on. So when we look at the general impact factors that we discussed a couple of episodes ago, I adjusted it slightly to represent the differences that we see in material extrusion. So for example, the impact factor, machine and technology, it's definitely still the feedstock delivery. So for example, if you have a Bowden style machine where the filament is actually conveyed and fed much further away from the nozzle than other styles, then the slicing itself, the layer height that we're getting, the pass planning, when do we return to a certain location is important. The heaters, the position of the thermocouple in the heaters changes what we set as a temperature and what we achieve as a temperature, very important. For the feedstock, we also have other impact factors. In production, very critical are the dimensions. And I indicated here with the tolerance. So we're talking about filament now that's being fed. And we're feeding with a constant feed rate, but if our filament has deviations in the diameter, if it has voids inside, then for the same amount of length of filament, we're actually getting more or less material fed into our printhead, and that has an effect. So production is also critical here, and also the composition of the feedstock, what type of plastic we're having, if we have fillers, all of that has an effect then on the rheological, thermal, optical, mechanical, and other properties. When we look at processing, process parameters, again, they are always very important, but also the part orientation. I'll talk about that in one of the episodes that are to follow. And the temperature field. How does our material cool? If we have smaller sections, big parts, thin walls, all of that has an effect on warpage, for example, and the accuracy of the build that we're achieving. And then for the as-printed part, the surface is very important. Remember, we have a very rough stair-step-like structure. The dimensions are critical for assemblies, the density that we can achieve. We're putting a circular filament into the printhead, and we're extruding it out of a circular nozzle, but what we really want is a rectangular shape of the bead that's coming out. So it's very easy to get little voids at the cross-section, at the intersection of different beads. And for that, finishing is very important. And finishing can be polishing to a certain, tumbling, for example, with media, or vapor smoothing, which is quite common. Depending on what material you have, you can do that. And that all affects the process and properties of the component that we're getting. So as we've already discussed, a lot of the different analysis methods, especially thermal analysis and rheology, when we talked in the previous episodes about powder bed fusion, I'm summarizing that a little bit, so we're not going through all of it again. But I want to start with the critical parameters along the filament path, starting with the feeding of the filament. So when we're feeding the material, we have the filament go through feeding gears, and we need enough flexure modulus first to spool the filament on the material, and then as it's going in here, we need column strength because the filament is used as a piston to push or pump the material through the nozzle. So we can't have it buckle. So we need to know the temperature-dependent modulus, and that we measure with dynamic mechanical analysis. You should check out one of the previous episodes if you missed it and you want to learn more about it. So we have the filament fed into the nozzle. Now we're looking at the melting behavior in the nozzle. The melting really depends on the heat flux and the thermal conductivity of the polymer filament, as well as the filament diameter and the feed rate. So what I tried to highlight here is that the heat conduction goes from the wall to the center. The thicker the material is, so the larger our filament, a 2.85, will need more time to melt than a 1.75. If we push really fast, we don't allow our material enough time to be melted. And so this is moving further down. The blue would be moving further down, and eventually we might not get material out until we have a little stop and the melting can catch up. So in order to understand that, differential scaling colorimetry, DSC, and laser flash analysis, LFA, are crucial to understand that. Then we're interested in, at the end of the nozzle, what volatiles come out. Because these material extrusion printers are so much used in home use environments, there is more question than in an industrial setting, how you get rid of the vapors, the fumes. You normally don't have exhaust, so the volatiles are important, and we can use coupled methods, evolved gas methods, coupling of TG, FDIR, or TG, GCMS. And I have been talking about that in the 3D Printing Myth Explained videos. So go and check those out if you're interested in understanding that better. Then the next step is the material coming out of the nozzle, so exiting here. In order for the material to flow, we need sufficiently low viscosity that the material is pushed out easily, and the force of the solid filament pushing as like a piston is strong enough to push the material out. And we also want to produce a well-defined bead. We don't want change in diameter coming out. So for that, we want to use capillary rheometer to measure the viscosity. And because we're squeezing something out of a thin nozzle, we want to know about the shear rate dependent viscosity. And I'll talk about that in the next two episodes. So the material exits the nozzle. The next important thing is the bead formation and the bonding between layers. Bead formation really means we want a low viscosity that the material comes out, but as a bead is being deposited, we don't want the material to just run off the sides. We want it to keep the shape, not flow out of shape, but we also want it to be pliable enough that the next layer deposition or even the bead next to it can still deform it a little bit, so we get the closest packaging that that we can achieve. So again, that depends on the viscosity and the viscosity change once cooling sets in and affects the print resolution. The bonding means the contact area between the neighboring beads and the void size that results from that is important. And the bonding depends on molecular mobility. And that has something to do with the relaxation time of the material. How much time do we have for the material to still, the molecular chains to still move and go across the bead boundary. And for that, we would use rotational rheometry in oscillation because we want to understand the viscoelastic properties and relaxation times. And here, I just picked a micro CT image that shows that in this case, the build platform actually was too low for the position of the nozzle and the sliced G-code. And what we see here, we get perfectly round beads, which is something we really don't want. And as we're going up layer by layer, we have really big voids here. The voids become smaller and smaller, and eventually we get a really homogeneous, densely packed part. So that's what I mean with bead formation and bonding. We really want it, the material to still be reshaped into a more rectangular geometry to get rid of voids. And last but not least, I talked about that quite a bit with powder bed fusion, and I also talked about that in one of the 3D printing myth explained videos, and that's warpage. Warpage means that the material deforms and doesn't stay flat because of temperature differences. And temperature differences, I wanted to show you that video that we took at the Polymer Engineering Center, University of Wisconsin-Madison, and it really shows you that at the bottom we have the lower temperatures and we really deposit that hot material on top. So this temperature gradient is the cause for warpage, and the potential for warpage is defined by the coefficient of thermal expansion. That means how much a material changes its volume or length as it's cooled or heated. And also the modulus, because the modulus determines how stiff a material gets over a certain temperature range. So in order to study that, we need the temperature-dependent modulus, again, through dynamic mechanical analysis, DMA, and we need the coefficient of thermal expansion that we get through thermomechanical analysis, TMA. And check out the previous videos if you want to understand the basic concept of that in the context of polymer powder bed fusion, and the same applies to material extrusion.